To begin, let's briefly go over what exactly ALS is. ALS stands for Amyotrophic Lateral Sclerosis and is a rare and progressive neurodegenerative disease only affecting about 3,000 Canadians. ALS causes gradual paralysis in affected individuals due to the communication issues between the brain and the muscles of the body that are associated with voluntary movement. This is a result of the degeneration and death of motor neurons. Specifically, both the upper motor neurons and lower motor neurons play a role in ALS progression. Upper motor neurons are a part of the central nervous system of the brain and are responsible for carrying information regarding the initiation of voluntary movement. These upper motor neurons are connected to the lower motor neurons, who are confined to the spinal cord. Ultimately, lower motor neurons connect to the muscles of the body and allow them to complete the voluntary movement. Think of it like a relay race. The brain passes information to the upper motor neurons, who then carry this information and give it to the lower motor neurons. These lower motor neurons then complete the race by passing it to the endpoint, the muscle. With ALS, both the upper motor neurons and lower motor neurons are damaged, so the muscles are unable to receive voluntary action signals because of inadequate communication. This causes the muscles to lose their ability to perform proper function and they begin to waste away. Thus, the brain progressively loses the ability to commence and regulate voluntary actions. Now, let's discuss how exactly someone is diagnosed with ALS. In order for a physician to diagnose an individual with ALS, there are some requirements that must be met according to the widely accepted Escorial criteria. This criteria can be broken down into two parts. The first component of the criteria states that for an ALS diagnosis, it requires the presence of three factors. 1. Evidence of lower motor neuron degeneration. 2. Evidence of upper motor neuron degeneration. And 3. The progression of symptoms and signs spreading region to region or within a region. To check for this criteria mentioned and determine evidence of motor neuron degeneration, the signs and symptoms of an individual has to be observed. When discussing the signs of a disease, we are referring to what can be seen or measured in an individual. Signs of upper motor neuron degeneration are associated with weakness and atrophy, whereas signs of lower motor neuron degeneration are related to spasticity and pathologic reflexes. Thus, here we have compiled a list of signs associated with ALS, which may include tripping, slurred speech, and difficulty swallowing. Whereas symptoms are what an individual experiences or feels, shown are some symptoms that may lead a doctor to suspect ALS. This includes feeling of weakness, fatigue, and muscle cramping. There's difficulty in diagnosing ALS because its signs and symptoms may be similar to other neurological diseases like West Nile virus, polio, and many others. However, the second part of the Escorial criteria helps rule out the other possibilities. Essentially, this part of the criteria states that diagnosis requires the absence of two factors. 1. Evidence that may explain that the signs of lower and upper motor neuron degeneration are caused by another disease. Or 2. Evidence that may explain that the observed clinical signs were caused by another disease. This part of the criteria is verified using various tests, which include electromyogram, magnetic resonance imaging, blood and urine tests, and muscle biopsy. We will now provide you all with some details about the tests listed before. For an electromyogram, also known as EMG, the doctor evaluates the electrical activity by inserting a needle electrode into various muscles through the skin. The electrical activity tells the doctor when those specific muscles in the body are contracting and when they are resting. These help the doctor determine whether they have another nerve or muscle condition causing the same symptoms. Used in conjunction with other tests, EMGs study the extent to which nerves are supplied to muscles or the lack of. They are also used to confirm lower motor neuron degeneration. The magnetic resonance imaging, also known as the MRI test, uses various radio waves and magnetic fields to produce images of the spinal cord and the brain. This is not used as frequently, but in rare cases, MRIs of spinal cord may provide enough information to support the diagnosis of ALS. Doctors may also request a blood and urine test to be completed. Analyzing blood and urine samples allows them to get rid of the other practical causes of symptoms and signs. Notably, there's a special marker in our blood and urine samples called 80H2DG. This marker is an indicator of oxidative stress experienced by our bodies. In other words, this marker is a modified version of our DNA, which forms as a result of the DNA consistently going through damage and repair due to ALS. As such, those with ALS will see increased levels of this marker. If the doctor is more convinced that an individual has a muscle disease over having ALS, the doctor will recommend them to go through a muscle biopsy. During this, a part of the muscle is removed and gets analyzed in a lab. Biopsies are not typically done unless there is overlapping in symptoms observed in other diseases. As such, this is used as a last resort in the diagnosis process. In conclusion, by meeting each of the points in the aforementioned criteria, a physician is able to diagnose an individual with ALS. Preceding this, the patient will receive the recommended treatment to help with reducing symptom severity. To get more information on the diagnosis of ALS or any ALS-related information, please visit ALS Canada.